The copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars. Attention all Los Angeles County Sheriff's cars. Broadcast 113 regarding a murder. A body found in Mint Canyon. Face mutilated with a shotgun. That's all. Rolls and quits. Gasoline above all other brands. Recent public figures show that for the year 1935, 4.5 million gallons of Rio Grande cracked gasoline were used in thousands of police cars, fire engines, police motorcycles, and emergency cars operated by cities, counties, and other governmental units. To protect your lives and your property, all these divisions of your government have selected Rio Grande cracked gasoline, because it gives the most outstanding emergency performance. They choose Rio Grande cracked in preference to any other brand of gasoline available in this market, because their accurate records prove conclusively that it operates cars more efficiently and more economically. Several hundred thousand motorists must agree with their government in the selection of an ideal gasoline. For the sale of Rio Grande crack is 140% ahead of last year, making Rio Grande by far the fastest growing oil company in the West. And now it is our great pleasure to present once more Sheriff Gene Discalouse of Los Angeles County. Sheriff Discalouse.
Good evening, friends. You hear a great deal from time to time of sentimental objections to capital punishment. People with more milk of human kindness in their souls and hard factual experience in their background maintain that man has not the legal right to take a life in the name of society, that the criminal should be corrected, not executed. I ask you to listen carefully to tonight's dramatization and ask yourself whether the criminal about whom you are to hear could have been dealt with differently. Personally, I believe that the only way to deal with avaricious, cold-blooded killers is to make an example of them. It is sad but true that the strongest crime deterrent is the fear of consequences. It has been my experience that so many people are not good so often because it is the right thing to do, as they are good because they are afraid they will be punished if they are bad. If a guilty plotter is wise, he will change his mind, for I can assure him he will not get away with it any more than John Vittori did.
I am Jose Diego. I was paroled from the Arizona State Prison at Florence on May 12, 1933. They sent me there for burglary. Maybe I was useless. What is a man to do when he's hungry and when there is no work? They drove a bunch of us over to Phoenix the day they let us out. I went from there to the coast. I am Luis Blanco. I was having a hard time in Los Angeles. The county gave me food and they gave me work now and then, but I didn't ever have enough to eat. My wife was in the insane asylum in Scotland. I didn't know many people in Los Angeles except her relatives. So I left for Arizona on April 10th. My sister lives in Globe and I hope maybe I could get a job there. At least I could eat.
I'm John Vittori. Louis Blanco is my brother-in-law. That is his wife and my wife and sister. He disappeared a month ago. Last thing he told me, he was going to San Francisco to look for work. Now his wife is well enough to get out of Patton, and he's got to sign the papers. We can't find him anywhere. So I reported him to the police as a missing person. I hope they find him. Certainly I ain't going to sign for his wife's release. I've got too many mouths to feed now with my own wife and the kids.
Lust are the three chief protagonists in this drama of greed and violence. The prologue has spoken. The action has already begun in a lonely canyon in the foothills with the captives. And now the curtains part on the first scene in the office of Captain William Bright, head of the homicide squad, Los Angeles County Sheriff's Office, as the telephone rings.
Homicide, Bright speaking.
Good.
Yes, George.
Mr.
Heaver
reported
of
a murder up in Lake
Cannon. Oh,
he's
George Murder?
Yes,
the
man
informed
me that the body was found on his
ranch.
In fact, tight.
All right. You go on out there, and I'll get a couple of men and follow you right away.
Yes, sir.
While Stewart and Deputy Sheriff Brewster and Dickerson are making a cursory investigation of the scene of the crime, Captain Bright, accompanied by Deputies Morell, Sepulveda, and Morford, speed through San Fernando Valley on their way to Newhall. Stewart greets them on their arrival.
Well, Stewart, what is it?
Billy Goose and Miss. Just this way, Captain. Who do you please? Shotgun. He found the shells. One shot killed him, and the second was fired while the victim was lying on the ground. It fired close, as you can tell by the powder burns on the clothing. And it was the second shot which obliterated the feces.
Yes, you're right on the reconstruction. Apparently, the victim was a Mexican. Any marks on the clothes?
No, sir.
Any identification?
Yes, that's the same part of it. Although the murderer apparently wanted to make recognition impossible, he overlooked a slip of paper which he found in the victim's shirt pocket.
Oh. My name is Louis Blanco, 1720 Yale Street, Los Angeles. In case of accident or serious illness, notify John Vittori, 602 Stella Avenue, Los Angeles. Find anything else on him?
Well, we haven't traced him thoroughly. I didn't want to move the body until you arrived.
You've got photographs of it by now, haven't you?
Yes.
Well, then, let's see if he has anything else on him. I'm not satisfied with this identification.
Yes, sir. Brewster, examine the body and see what else you can find on him.
Yes.
Who found the body?
This young fellow here. Hired man on the ranch.
Oh? You found the body?
Yes, sir. I was out hunting him, and I stepped right on the body. Gee, like to scare the daylights out of me.
When is this?
This morning. I told the boss about it right away. And he called you fellas.
Looks like he's been dead 24 hours. Hear any shots yesterday?
Why, no. Come to think of it, believe I did. I was out looking for a stray cow. And I heard a couple of shots.
What time was this?
About 11 o'clock yesterday morning. I didn't pay no attention to the shots because I figured somebody else was out hunting.
Did you see anyone around here?
Well, no, but about 15 minutes later, I was walking along a back road on the way back to the ranch. I didn't find the cow, you see. And a fellow passed me in a car going west.
That's the four-door thing?
Yes, sir.
What kind of a car was it?
It was a Nessie sedan.
Did you notice the license number?
No, I didn't.
What color was it?
It was blue, only kind of faded, and it had a black top.
Here's some more papers I found on the body, Captain.
Uh-huh.
These were in his hip pocket.
Thanks. Let's see. Well, according to these papers, this man is Jose Diego. Released from the Arizona State Penitentiary at Florence on May 12th. Today's the 24th. Well, if his body is Diego, he enjoyed just 12 days of freedom.
And if it's Luis Blanco, how did he get possession of Jose Diego's parole paper?
Well, it seems that the answer to that lies in this John Vittori. Morell, I want you to go to 602 Stella Avenue and bring in John Vittori. By the time you get him, the body will be in the morgue. Take him there for an identification and bring him to my office.
Yes, sir.
Sepulveda.
Yes, sir.
I want you to follow through on fingerprinting this body. Send the classification to the Arizona Penitentiary at Florence for a check against the Prince of Jose Diego. Come on now, step on it, boys. We've got one corpse with two identities. I don't like mysteries when they're that mysterious.
Sepulveda fingerprints the corpse, Morell picks up John Vittori at the Cellar Street address. At the morgue, Victoria identifies the body as his brother-in-law, Billy Blanco. Then Victoria leads the officers to Blanco's rooming house on Yale Street. The Mexican landlady greets them at the door.
Ah, buenos dias, Senor Vittori. Have you heard from that brother-in-law of yours who owes me so much back rent?
Yes, Mr. Gonzalez. I've heard of him. He's been murdered.
Murdered?
This man is from the sheriff's office. He wants to go to Lou's room.
Bueno. But who is going to pay his back rent? Are you, Senor Vittori?
You know I ain't got no money.
Mrs. Gonzalez, do you know whether Blanco had a gun?
A gun? Oh, no. He didn't have no gun.
Did he have an automobile?
An automobile? Where would he get the money for an automobile when he owed me 3 months' rent?
Are his things still in his room?
Oh, see, such as they are. He didn't have very much.
I'd like to take a look in there.
He's just down the hall here. He said when he went away that he was going to get a job in San Francisco. And now he comes back murdered.
Yeah, that's what he told me, too. That he was going to Frisco to get a job.
Here's his room.
Oh. That's pretty bare. No clothes.
Oh, no. He didn't have no clothes. Only what he wore.
Some old magazine.
There are some letters in the drawer there.
Oh, that's what I'm looking for. A letter from Mrs. Rosita Tapoca, Globe, Arizona. You know who this is, Mr. Vittori?
I think he had a sister in Globe.
That's fine. Well, come along.
Where are we going now?
Down to headquarters. The captain wants to ask you some questions.
Would appreciate your making confidential investigations
to discover if Blanco is now in Globe. W. Biscaloo, Sheriff, Los Angeles County.
Sheriff E. W. Biscaloo, Los Angeles, California. Louis Blanco arrived here from Los Angeles April 10th. Now staying with sister, Charles R. Burns, Sheriff, Globe, Arizona.
Sheriff Charles R. Burns, Globe, Arizona. Please question Blanco and search for 12-gauge shotgun and blue automobile with black tops. Possible victim brought from there by car. E.W. Biscaloo, Sheriff, Los Angeles County.
Sheriff E.W. Biscaloo, Los Angeles. Unable to check or find either automobile or shotgun. Holding Blanco in custody. Refuses to waive extradition. Awaiting instruction. Charles R. Burns, Sheriff, Globe, Arizona.
Sheriff Charles R. Burns, Globe, Arizona. Deputy Sheriff Sepulveda and Morrell arrive Globe tomorrow to question Blanco. Many thanks for your cooperation. W. Biscaloo, Sheriff, Los Angeles County.
Handwriting?
Yes.
And that body you saw in the morgue, you're satisfied that is your brother-in-law, Louis Blanco?
Sure. That's him, as far as I can tell. Sure looks like his hands and looks like his clothes, too.
Mm-hmm. Then you sure it was him?
Sure.
Bring in your man, Morello.
Yes, sir. Come on in.
You know this fellow, Vittorio?
Louis. Oh, hello, Louis.
See you. I'm glad to see you. Thought you was dead.
I am not dead. I was pretty scared.
What were you scared about?
Somebody tried to get me. They got the wrong guy. They put my name in his pocket.
Yeah, that's what the officers and me is trying to find out about.
Did you write this identification card, Blanco?
No, I ain't never tried before.
Well, who do you think wrote it?
Lord, you were the story's brother-in-law.
Nobody knows it, except in his own family. Nobody knows it in my family.
Just in John's family.
That's right.
Did the story ever talk to you about an insurance policy?
Yes. He comes to me one day and asked me to take out his policy so he could get a job with the insurance company. He said he'd pay for it, so I said, okay, this is what is helping.
That ain't so. Well, did you ever get the policy?
No.
And who was the beneficiary?
My wife.
How much was the policy for?
He said $1,000.
That ain't so. Well, do you think this boy's lying to you?
He's lying 100%.
Oh. What do you say to that, Blanco?
Wrong. They've got to find out sooner or later.
Sure, the law finds out, and it finds out soon.
You know you made me sign that insurance application.
You're lying, Louis.
Listen, Vittori. Your blue Essex was seen up there when we found that body.
Not mine.
Why, the man who saw the car drive down the road has identified it. Identified it by the color, the top, and the sticker you've got on the windshield.
Not mine. I could swear and tear my heart out.
Well, whose blue Essex was it then?
Oh, I don't know anything about it, sir. Lots of blue Essexes.
And this identification card. What do you know about that?
Never saw it before the day this officer came up to the house.
Here's a piece of paper and pencil, Vittori. Now, write down what I tell you.
All right.
Louis Blanco. 1720 Yale Street. Los Angeles. Is that that? Then write John Vittori. Now write 1720 years, Street a couple of times. How far did you go in school, Vittori?
Sixth grade.
Never learned to spell those English, did you?
That's right, the way I got it.
Look at it again.
Sure, that's right.
Well, here. Take a look at this morning paper. See the way they spell it. There's no I in it.
Oh. Oh, yeah. I forgot.
Now, how about Yale Street? Did you spell it right there?
Sure.
What's the matter, Vittori? What are you sweating for?
It's hot in here.
Yeah. Isn't it? How do you spell Yale, Vittori?
Y-E-L-L.
You sure of that?
Sure I am.
I'm going to place you under arrest, Vittori, on suspicion of murder.
No. No, I ain't guilty of anything.
Maybe not. But this identification card we found on the body spelled Yale the same way you do, Sergeant.
Yes, sir?
Put this man on suspicion of murder.
Yes, sir.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute, Sergeant. Blanco, I'll have to put you through as a material witness. Although I want you to know that as far as we're concerned, we don't hold any suspicion against you. You're a matter of detention in jail for a few days.
Well, that's okay, Captain. I ain't got no place to stay anyway. I owe too much rent to buy my place to go back there.
Okay. I got a say, Sergeant.
Yes.
For your information, Vittori, you spell Yale, Y-A-L-E. Now, Morrell.
Yes, sir?
I want you to check all the insurance companies for a policy on Louis Blanco. I have an idea that policy will be the key to this case.
Yes, sir.
For several days, Morrell devotes his time to the painstaking task of checking the files for Los Angeles Insurance Company.
and at last discovers the company which holds the policy on Blanco's life. The agent who handles the policy is contacted, is brought in to Captain Bright for questioning.
Salesman, Mr. Walters?
Yes,
I am. Mm-hmm. You know Mr. John Vittori?
Yes.
How'd you happen to meet him?
Well, I contacted him first on a cold gander.
What's that?
Well, that's what we call it when you get a prospect's name out of a phone book and approach him with no other lead than just his name and address.
I see. And did you sell Mr. Vittori insurance on that car?
No, not on that call, but 2 months later I went to see him again, and that time he made out an application for a policy. Turned out.
Why?
He'll help.
Was that the last you saw of him?
Well, no. I gave him 2 or 3 application blanks and suggested to some other members of his family or his friends might want to be insured.
Uh-huh.
Well, a few days later, he came back with this application of Louis Blanco. I told him to be sure the name was clearly printed, and Blanco not only had printed his name at the top of the application, but also at the signature. Well, the company rejected it, and I gave it back to Vittori and told him to have it signed. A few days later, he returned the application signed.
And who was the beneficiary?
Well, the beneficiary was himself, John Vittori.
But Blanco told us that maybe his wife was the beneficiary.
Yes, but as I remember, Vittori explained he changed his mind because he didn't think his wife could collect the insurance. She was in the hospital at Patton.
I asked you to bring along the papers pertaining to this policy. Have you the application there?
Yes, here in my briefcase. A minute. Here it is. Here he signed Louis Blanco.
Mm-hmm. Well, have you got those record cards on Blanco and Vittori?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, here they are, sir. Hey. Hey, this is signed Louis Blanco. But you don't have to be an expert to see that the handwriting is not the same on this application and on Blanco's record card here.
Why, that's right, isn't it?
And the date on this application is April 15th. When did Blanco say he left Los Angeles, man?
April 10th. He definitely placed him in Globe, Arizona on the 12th.
I'd say his signature on the application is mighty close to the Tory's handwriting, wouldn't you, Merle?
Yes, sir.
How much was this policy for?
There were 2 units for $1,500 apiece.
So that's the price of the murder, huh? $3,000. Well, Mr. Walters, I think you've given us the evidence we need here to complete our case against John Vittori.
Well, I'm glad to be of assistance. We're just as eager to uncover this sort of mass practice as you are. There's one more thing.
What's that?
Vittori took out another policy which named himself beneficiary.
He did? On who?
Just a minute. I have it here. There it is. And Mike Rufo, age 14. His nephew.
Oh, Mike Rufo, huh? That's Blanco's stepson. His wife's boy by a former marriage.
Well, it looks as though Mr. Vittori planned to make a lot of dough on his family. However, I doubt if we can use that as evidence against him. It'd be hard to establish intent, even though Vittori had his nephew in line for the next killing.
In a few short days, the case of John Vittori is ready for the case of John Vittori is ready for prosecution and handed over to the office of district attorney, Duran Fitz, who characterized it as magnificently prepared. And in December 1933, Vittori is brought to trial in Department 26 of Superior Court before Judge Aguilar. The prosecution bases its argument that Vittori murdered Jose Diego for $3,000 worth of insurance upon 3 circumstantial facts. The first,
Vittori's car was seen by a witness where the murder occurred.
The second, Vittori consistently misspelled the word Yale in the manner in which it was spelled on the identification card found on the body.
The third, Vittori forged applications for $3,000 worth of insurance upon the life of Louis Blanco and named himself his beneficiary.
The jury finds the defendant guilty of murder in the first degree.
And Judge Aguilar sentences Vittori
to hang by the neck until death,
which sentence was carried out at San Quentin at dawn on December 6, 1935.
More boys and girls listen to Calling All Cars than to any other program heard over this station. And the Rio Grande Oil Company is glad to cooperate with local police authorities in crime prevention by impressing the youthful mind that crime does not pay. To further enlist boys and girls on the side of law and order,
Rio Grande offers a complete junior detective outfit absolutely free of charge to its young listeners. A police badge, handcuffs, pistol belt and holster, fingerprint outfit, and many other free gifts. Ask any independent dealer selling Rio Grande cracked gasoline for a free copy of the Calling All Cars News, which contains the story and pictures of the crimes of her tonight, and tells how you may get your complete junior police outfit without charge. Rio Grande is proud to take the leadership in this junior police crime prevention movement. Remember, Rio Grande cracked gasoline today powers more police cars, fire engines, and emergency equipment than any other brand.
Attention all cars. Attention all Los Angeles County Sheriff's cars. A cancellation of broadcast 113 regarding a murder in Mint Canyon. Suspecting this case now in custody. That's all. Roll the tape.